McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Leadership in the Era of Economic Uncertainty, Managing in a Downturn by Ram Charan, narrated by Walter Dixon. Foreword. The economic cyclone continues to rage, and nobody knows when it will end. If you're like most business people, you've never experienced so much change and uncertainty or faced such a deep downturn. You've seen Wall Street all but disappear. You wonder if your company too might cease to exist. Yet others are looking to you for strength and guidance. Whether you lead a small group of people or a whole business unit or company, these next few weeks, months, and years will test you. You cannot let yourself be afraid of what is yet to come. Instead, you have to see it coming sooner and move faster. Can you be the leader who confronts the brutal reality first? Who figures out what has to be done and makes sure it happens? Who finds opportunities in chaos and whose confidence is contagious? The author of this valuable book, Ram Charan, has advised key leaders for more than 30 years and has taught extensively in many of the world's best companies. Charan has witnessed multiple economic contractions marked by economic uncertainty. He has observed some managements that have navigated these challenging periods superbly and others who have failed miserably. The task is not for the faint of heart, nor is it for the CEO and CFO alone. While those two leaders certainly are right in the middle of the action in a contracting economic environment, this book contends that every one of a business's constituents has an important role to play. Rather than just asserting this point, Charan provides explicit guidance for all business functions and outside parties. It will surprise you to hear, for example, of the important contributions salespeople can provide in this setting, as well as the board of directors. It is also crucial to understand how the efforts of multiple business functions need to be aligned and coordinated in a way that gets everyone in the same boat and rowing together. Finally, Charan points out that both the candor and the frequency of communication are critical in these times of uncertainty. Leaders who are realistic about their external environment but still positive and reinforcing in responding to the difficulties will more than likely be successful. In this historic period, leadership in the era of economic uncertainty can be an invaluable partner in navigating your way in troubled economic waters. I can't think of a better person to provide advice on dealing with uncertainty and a downturn than Ram Charan. Listen, learn, survive, prosper. Larry Bossidy, former Chairman and CEO, Honeywell International, Inc. Introduction. Corporate Crisis. The first clear sign that the economic crisis was spreading globally and moving beyond the financial industry came to DuPont CEO Chad Holliday while he was visiting a major customer in Japan. The CEO of the Japanese company, among the largest and most highly regarded in its global industry, told Holliday he was worried about his company's cash position and had ordered his executives to conserve cash in case the financial contagion spread. Talk about a wake-up call. When Holliday's plane landed in the United States on Monday night, he immediately summoned the six top leaders in his company to a meeting at 7 a.m. the next day. He asked them the following questions. How bad is it now? How bad could it get? The answers that came back over the next few days were grim. The financial industry's problems were pervading many aspects of DuPont's business, both at home and abroad. What had seemed to be a crisis of confidence in Wall Street had the potential to become a global crisis, as Western Europe, Russia, and most of Asia were swept by the panic. Credit was disappearing, leaving companies struggling to finance their operations. The evidence of how serious the problems were becoming appeared in different places. Wilmington, where DuPont has its headquarters, is usually a hotbed of legal activity because so many companies are chartered in the state of Delaware and corporate lawsuits are filed in the Delaware Chancery Court in Wilmington. Bookings at the hotel DuPont owns in downtown Wilmington plunged by more than 30% in 10 days as lawyers representing companies engaged in litigation canceled their reservations when their clients decided to settle their disputes and stop incurring legal fees. More telling was the rate at which production at many companies was slowing. DuPont Paint covers over 30% of American automobiles, and the company generally manufactures the paint less than 48 hours before it is sprayed onto new cars. To maintain that short a lead time, the automobile companies share their production schedules with DuPont. Suddenly, there weren't any production schedules. The automakers didn't know what they were going to produce in the face of collapsing sales. Clearly, it was time to take action. DuPont has long been in the forefront of contingency planning. It has a plan dubbed the Corporate Crisis Plan that, if invoked, instantly brings together DuPont's senior managers to appraise the cause of the crisis and put appropriate disaster control procedures in place. The plan is seldom called up. It was used in the wake of the 9/11 attacks and in the aftermath of major hurricanes. Holiday had to weigh whether the gathering financial storm was serious enough to warrant implementing it, or whether declaring a crisis might frighten the company's 60,000 employees needlessly. As the evidence for a deepening economic downturn quickly mounted, he decided that corporate crisis was right. The plan immediately brought together the 17 standing teams that always assemble when a crisis is declared. Over the course of 4 days, it became clear that the nature of the crisis was only financial, and 8 teams were stood down. At the end of the 4 days, the remaining 9 had determined what needed to be done to ensure DuPont's viability. It was time to let the troops around the world know what was going on. Communications with employees took several forms. Holiday enlisted the company's chief economist and the head of its pension fund, both of whom are highly regarded in the company, to explain, in non-technical language, the roots of the crisis and the way it was affecting the company. The pension fund manager also took time to develop some instructional material, advising employees about investment options for the $18 billion in retirement funds. Within 10 days of the formulation of plans to deal with the crisis, every employee in DuPont had a face-to-face meeting with a manager who explained what the company needed to do. Each employee was asked to identify 3 things he or she could do immediately to help conserve cash and reduce costs. Within a few days after the communications program was rolled out, the company conducted polling to see how well employees understood the nature of the crisis, determine their psychological reaction, were they scared or were they energized and ready to confront the crisis, and see whether they actually were doing what they needed to be doing. Overall, the employees seemed to get it. It helped that the news media were full of stories about the developing financial crisis. The actions aimed at conserving cash were taking hold quickly. Travel was curtailed sharply, internal meetings were canceled, and consultants and contractors were eliminated where possible. Nevertheless, Holiday had a feeling that people still didn't grasp the urgency with which they needed to be acting. In hindsight, maybe we were too good at giving them the reassurance and confidence that we could come through this, Holiday said. We gave them so much confidence that they just weren't responding as fast as the slowdown demanded. Together with his CEO and CFO, Holiday took the time to spend an hour and a half with each of the company's top 14 leaders. They were asked to explain what they were doing to cope with the crisis. They all brought long lists and seemed to feel confident that they were doing a lot, but the problem was how fast it was getting done. They were talking about things that would be implemented by January or February, but they were things we needed to implement in October, Holiday said. Even as the immediate crisis measures were being put in place, DuPont had a 3-person team of top executives looking at longer-term actions the company needed to take. It would take a while to figure out which production facilities could be closed permanently or shuttered temporarily to reduce costs. But the fastest way to save the most cash was to cut back as much as possible on the over 20,000 outside contractors the company had hired. In most cases, a contractor could be released with 1 week's notice and without any severance costs. Where possible, internal employees, whose operations were slowing or would be closed, were shifted into what was formerly contract work. DuPont's initial reaction to the spreading economic crisis took place in less than 6 weeks. There will be much more to do, depending on how the global economy fares over the next year or two. Even when the slowdown ends and things return to normal, Holiday is predicting that the inflationary trends that preceded the financial meltdown will reassert themselves. But DuPont will be ready for that too, if and when it happens. Chad Holiday answered the call for leadership. He stared into the face of uncertainty and accepted the change he saw coming. Neither fear nor uncertainty paralyzed him. He took charge, pulled people together, and took decisive action. This is what every leader must do now. Chapter 1. The Challenge of Managing in a Toxic Environment. Management challenges don't come any bigger than this. It's not just your business or industry that is in a downturn. The entire global economic system has been wounded. The liquidity crisis that erupted in September 2008 with the collapse of a few U.S. investment banks spread to businesses and consumers everywhere with a speed that left people as stunned as the victims of an automobile accident. By November, virtually every major developed country in the world was either in recession or suffering from a wrenching slowdown in growth. Other countries whose economies are still growing also have felt the effects. Even India's enviable 7% GDP growth rate is down considerably from its previous levels of around 9%, driving home the irrefutable point that the world is connected as never before, sometimes in unpredictable ways. Projections and estimates in these circumstances are little more than guesses. In August 2008, who would have predicted that Wall Street, as we knew it for 50 years, would simply disappear? Accustomed as we were to the easy availability of capital, who would have imagined that credit would simply dry up on a global scale? Going forward, who can say how much capital will be available for expansion? Which countries and markets will contract, and at what rates? How long will the contraction last, or could it become a depression? Will disinflation give way to deflation, followed by a surge of inflation? We will not know when we have turned the corner, and we cannot envision the shape and scope of the world that will emerge. What we can be sure of is that this is a time of tumultuous change, and with change comes both danger and opportunity. The financial tsunami was a long time in the making, and its consequences inevitably will be with us for a long time. How long depends on how smart the various players around the world in government, finance, and business are in rebuilding the system. Credit is the oil of the economic engine, and credit ultimately is a creation of confidence. Until all players are confident about the intentions and strength of the others, there can only be stagnation. The economic peace of the last generation is over. We're in a war for survival, beset by fear, uncertainty, and doubt. As on any battlefield, conditions demand a seriously different kind of leadership from that which is appropriate in peacetime. Leaders must be prepared to make strategic, structural, financial, and operational changes, many of them drastic, in a hurry, and with information that is, at best, incomplete. As I wrote this in December 2008, most of the business leaders I was talking with were either deeply worried or, frankly, scared. Bewildered CEOs and directors were saying things such as, "Things are going over a cliff in no time," and "No one has ever seen such a vortex before." The most pessimistic foresaw a catastrophe on the order of the Great Depression. Some said it would take 1 year for the global economy to normalize. Others said it could take up to 3. However, I also found leaders who already had begun reshaping their businesses to carry on through whatever hard times lie ahead. They are making changes now to emerge in better shape than ever, ready for the growth that ultimately will come. Some are pouncing on the opportunity to move faster than their peers and serve customers in different ways. These are the companies that will be among the game changers in the next expansion. One word: cash. In the face of a downturn that is deeper, more widespread, and more sustained than anything you have experienced before, you have to adjust your most fundamental thoughts about what your business will look like and how it will be run. The immediate challenge is to act quickly and decisively to prepare for the worst possible scenario. Unless you already had plans and processes in place for a crisis, like Chad Holliday of DuPont, that is more difficult than one might expect. People tend to overestimate how well their company will fare because that is what they want to believe. Such misplaced optimism can lead to inaction or indecision, with dire consequences. If you conscientiously prepare for the worst, chances are that you will encounter something less bad than that and come out ahead when it is all over. If you don't prepare for the worst, you will put both your company and your career at risk. Your focus must shift from the income statement to the balance sheet. Protecting cash flow is the most important challenge almost all companies face today, whether they realize it or not. Before the crisis struck, your company's indicators of success were increasing earnings per share and growing revenues by gaining market share. The most critical metric now is cash. Pursuit of revenue growth must give way to understanding the cash implications of everything your company does. You absolutely must have sufficient cash or credible access to it to weather the storm. And given today's information technology, you can and should know your company's cash position every single day. Cash has three internal sources: earnings from operations, working capital, inventories and receivables, and the sale of assets. All three must be pursued vigorously. Every sale must be weighed against not just how attractive the margin is, but how much cash will be tied up in inventories and receivables, and for how long. Projects that once were evaluated on the basis of their return on investment now must be judged in terms of how much cash they consume and can generate, and how soon they can bring in cash. To understand why the generation of cash is so important, one need look no farther than the American automobile industry's reckoning during fall 2008. Not only had consumers shifted from demanding highly profitable SUVs to wanting fuel-efficient cars, they also had fallen victim to the credit crunch. Auto and truck sales plunged, even as the companies were working feverishly to develop new models that would appeal to consumers. The reversal was so swift that General Motors announced in November that its available cash would last less than a year in the absence of a government rescue. None of the three automakers had a comfortable margin of cash on hand. With dismal sales, they were not generating much cash, and a lot of that cash essentially was locked up in inventory. They couldn't borrow substantial amounts because of their credit risk, and by that time, they had sold most of their presumed non-essential assets. Problems in the auto industry had been accumulating, but lack of liquidity can bring the mighty to their knees in less than 2 weeks. Witness the case of General Electric. A fundamentally solid company with a AAA rating, it was nevertheless hammered by 2 weeks of volatility in March 2008 and again the following September, requiring the CEO to get external capital at exorbitant rates. Management had to divert its attention from running the business to managing issues of liquidity. Because lack of liquidity will be an ever-present lethal threat, you will have to manage conservatively, lowering your cash break-even point as rapidly as possible for the worst-case scenario. Break-even points, calculated on a cash basis, will tell you what you need to do, whether it's discontinuing a product line, taking down a plant, or eliminating a distribution channel to survive the worst situation you can imagine. Don't underestimate how bad that scenario may be. For example, how might the most severe downturn you can imagine affect your debt repayment? Could you be in violation of your loan covenants? Today, many business people feel that they have no real problem because they don't have to refinance until the middle of 2010. What if that line of credit dries up? Also, don't forget that plummeting stock prices have turned many pension surpluses into liabilities that must be funded. You have to factor all these possibilities into your cash equation. Consider also that hard times may last longer than you think. The collapse of U.S. retailing in September 2008, called by some a 100-year flood, signaled a fundamental shift in consumer behavior. Spreading around the globe, it portends a long period in which demand will continue to decline or remain low as cash-short consumers forego or stretch out purchases. Stay focused on liquidity as you calculate your cash break-even, 1, 2, and maybe 3 years out. One company I advise is planning for a 10% reduction in unit volume and a 12% reduction in revenue in 2009 and again in 2010. The CEO and CFO are thinking ahead now about what it means if credit and market conditions remain severely impaired in 2010 when the company has to refinance debt. Rethinking growth. After spending their careers in a single-minded pursuit of growth, business leaders have to adjust their mentality. Some CEOs are telling their people that they should go for market share against competitors whose conditions could be unraveling. You should pursue that kind of growth only if it is profitable and cash efficient. Cash efficiency means that gains in market share do not consume disproportionate amounts of cash in the form of more inventory, extended duration of accounts receivable, or increased complexity. the cash efficiency of new market share is extremely important. This reality apparently was lost on Detroit's Big Three. Even as their scant resources were dwindling and while they were awaiting government help, industry executives were talking about plans to regain market share. That was pure fantasy, and to pursue that goal would have been deadly. Instead, what they desperately needed to do was reduce their overall market shares, cut product lines, prune the customer base, and try to gain share in cash-efficient and profitable segments. Protecting against a sudden liquidity crunch can mean thinking the previously unthinkable, such as deliberately giving up increases in revenue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.